What you are about to hear is an interview I had with Thomas Valentine Halleck, who I met through the Harmonic Convergence. You guys have heard me talk about these amazing souls that I've met during the Harmonic Convergence in the after party in the Zoom rooms. And one night, Thomas Valentine, Valentino as they call him in Italy, Valentino, just amazing, the Golden Son. That's why this episode is spelled S-O-N. Valentine Golden Son, S-O-N. Once you hear his crazy stories, there's lots of amazing twists and turns in this conversation. So, buckle up, you spirit knots.
This is Robert from Twin Peaks, and you're listening to Inspirado, Projecto.
Got a light.
Here's your fun fact. Did you know that if you reduced your daily calorie intake by 25%, it leads to improved mood, reduced tension, and a higher sex drive? Stay tuned to Inspirado Projecto for more fun facts.
Day out of time is art. But Gabriel Cousin was there, Dr. Gabriel Cousin, for global peace. They said for global peace, the tribe, then they got together. Unity is live on Facebook. And then they had Saturday Night Alive for Global Peace Tribe, and all the musicians, and they were in, you know, different parts of the world. I mean, it's amazing what they're doing, you know?
It's so cool to see this stuff happening where everybody is now, you know, now that these Facebook Live groups are happening where everyone, you know, all these people who are just into harmony and wanting to raise their vibrations and learning all these interesting things. Like during the Harmonic Convergence, there were just some extraordinary people from the Amazon Rainforest Shaman to Native elders, the Lakota tribe, giving their wisdom, and then a couple of people who were just really deep into the pyramids. It was so cool to hear all these different aspects and then to see how they all Venn diagrammed with each other, to see how that information came together.
Yes.
Gosh,
amazing, isn't it?
That's fascinating.
Yeah, I know, it is fascinating. And I go, oh man, I gotta stay with this. I got 4 hours just alone with the celebration, and another couple hours with the, that was with the tribe, that was in the evening. But then it was like 6 hours of all the lectures and speakers with Unify, with Mark. I mean, you know, it was unbelievable yesterday with the celebration they had.
So you see,
for Jose Aguirre, you know, for the Mayan.
So now
they're in Mexico, they're in the Bahamas, live, you know, with the artists, and then Mexico regards to the guardianship of perspective. You know, it was really, really very joyful and fulfilling for me because it's my life's work is to help humanity, you know, come together in the golden age.
So what are some of those key ways in which you feel that you're called to help out humanity in different ways? You mentioned handing out the Mayan calendars, which is awesome.
Yeah. So are we broadcasting now?
Yes.
Are we talking right now?
Yes.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah.
So, in ways to understand that I'm a yellow seed, a golden seed. So I plant like Johnny Appleseed, the divine light who we are, wherever I go, I plant that seed, like Johnny Appleseed, but it's a golden seed. And actually experience Earth, this is really something. I was in upstate New York, and I was there for Woodstock, the 25th anniversary. I was involved with a project called The Anatomy of Woodstock with Esther Williams was the author, and I was promoting her. I'm big into promoting when I believe in something for enlightenment. And I was flown in from Hawaii and back to the metropolitan New York. I had from Europe. I was coming in from Europe and back to New York to see my family. And then I got called. I went down the cellar, and I saw this picture of the 69 Woodstock. I go, what's going on in Woodstock? Is there any going? And I hear it's the 25th anniversary. And I got divine guidance. I got to go. Now, I wasn't planning on going. I was heading back to California, Hawaii.
Incredible.
Yeah. And that's my walk of faith, where I get called into, now I'm being called into Woodstock, the 25th anniversary. With Carlos Santana, I'm with the broadcasters, so that's my background. You know, I have the IT, I'm with the media, the television, artists. I was with the Rainbow Families. I got called in from around the world. They came for this anniversary. And what happened was, is when I went in, they said to me, I'm working with the Anatomy of Woodstock, the book with Esther, and I'm staying at the home in Woodstock. And I'm helping her with a family situation where the grandmother crossed over, and she's really concerned about her grandson, that he's being like possessed by evil spirits. And she wants them to be cleared. And so she showed up, she stays in the house, and I see the energy like a ghost, like Casper the Ghost. You see going down the stairs, they hide because they don't want you to see them unless you are open in that, and I am open in that way. And I said that she's stuck here, we need her to go on to the other planes to get more peace, but she's so concerned about you and your son that she won't leave till that gets taken care of. And boy, she was taken back, Esther, you know, by this. And she said, okay, well then I need to do. So we did the clearing. That's why I was there. And then after we did the clearing and everything, the healing for the family, I stayed there, and I was invited into Woodstock with her. And, you know, to help promote, because that was the whole reason she wanted me to come in. And I saw the Rainbow Families, man, the joyfulness of brothers and sisters of light, just like Woodstock in 69. I worked with the guy from Woodstock in 69. His name is Love 22. And Love 22, he has a $22 bill, like Uncle Sam, his face on it, and he's given. There's a $22 bill on the front with Uncle Sam, and on the back it says, the new world order is love, love 22. Everything's in harmony with 22, he said Valentine. Well, we got a hold of him. He had all these made up for kids and families, $22 bills he made into like pyramids and rings. So people took the $22 bills with them, you know, and I said, well, what's going on about 22? He says, well, you know, I was with seven other healers from South America. They were from Europe, Sweden, Russia, Italy, and then Mount Shasta, Hawaii with me. And we surrounded Love 22 because he needed the healing. And he said, Melba, it's never been the same since 69, but I feel such a release with you guys helping me with the healing. I didn't realize that I was holding on to this so much. Now, you would see him, the broadcaster, to say, there's Love 22. Now, let me tell you about the $22 bills that will really shock you and your audience and people around the world. Now, when he gave all these bills to, and now it's a $22 bill with Uncle Sam on it, but his face, and it looks like it's, you know, it looks like our currency in the United States. Well, people would go to the store with them and cash them. And then they're trying to get him in trouble. And I'm not kidding you. It went up to the Supreme Court. That's why he was upset. He told me about what happened.
Oh, my gosh.
He said, I've been holding this and holding this. That's why we did the healing on him. And he said, the courts went all the way up to the Supreme Court. And the judge looked at him and said, look, I'm throwing this out of the court. Because if they can't be awake and see it's a $22 bill, it's not a $20 bill. There's no $22 bill in our currency.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they were giving $22 bills.
Yeah.
They gave them $20 and some change. So they were making money on a $22
bill. Oh, my gosh.
California, East Coast, New York, it went everywhere.
Oh, my.
Europe. They try to use it everywhere, and they got away with it.
Oh, my gosh. This completely crazy idea for a $22 bill. And, you know, with and how could you look at that and even go, hey, this guy is trying to make counterfeit money. He's really trying. Because it's anyone who looks at it can see, okay, I've never seen this currency before in my life, you know. And so it's so funny that they would actually try to cash it in. And then it actually worked.
Yeah, it actually worked to go on. He said, look, Valentine, I got so much. There were $22 bills. He just wanted to get the fact that the new world order is 22. Love is the new world order on the back of the bill. And so it does look like our currency. It is our currency. It looks like, you know, if you're asleep and you got so many people as a customer, I can see where people can say, $22
bill.
They go, well, it's $20. I'll give you a change. But they give
them
change of
$22. Oh, my gosh. That is nuts. That is so crazy.
Talk about being asleep on the planet.
Yeah.
They're just so inundated with so many people at the register, you know?
Wow. Wow, and it's so great too, because that message is on there on that bill, so every time they look at it, they're reading the message, you know. So the message is always getting out there. What a powerful way for that to be promoted, huh?
Yeah, and that's what he said. When he said, "Valentine, never was the same. The flow, 69 Woodstock. There was never such a flow. Don't get me wrong. The 25th anniversary. I'm so happy to be here with the healing." And what you guys did for me was they healers with me, you know, surrounded me. They just came right over to me as I was about 22. They just surrounded me, you know, surrounded us with the energy. They felt the love and can we help in any way? And they knew me, you know, I was there at the concert and we got to gel together, you know, link in with different parts of the world and share our divine light. And they said, hey, can we help out? And they said, yeah. That'd be great, let's do it. And boy, he was so relieved from the divine golden light and the healing. He said he never felt the same, just like 69. That's what you're not getting chicken skin. That's the Holy Spirit. We get chicken skin when we call it Hawaiian, just so you know. You know, when you get goosebumps, we call it chicken skin Hawaii. The Hawaiians will laugh like, you know, about it when it goes through. Because they know it's God speaking.
Wow. Wow.
They breath. Yeah, yeah. It's just, you know, it's like goosebumps.
Yeah.
You get goosebumps, you know, you go, ooh, that just resonates what I just said, or I'm in harmony with it.
Ooh.
So people feel that chicken skin, which is going through me again. In other parts of the world, they would say the Holy Spirit, the doves of peace. You know, you're in harmony of something that you're being profoundly saying with the body, mind and spirit is in agreement. Yeah?
I love it. What a great way for the universe to speak through us, in addition to all the other wonderful synchronicities that it gifts us with.
So
during that time, I just want to pinpoint something here. You're talking about clearing out this woman's mother who had passed, you know, who transitioned.
Yeah.
What were some of the methods that you used? Some people might be interested. I'm interested. And what kind of methods did you use for the clearing? What, you know, did you chant something? Was there sage burned? What were some of the ingredients of this?
No, I actually went, it's very interesting because I actually saw her, like almost like a flower diva.
Wow.
Like a flower diva, and she was all like if you think of a spider's web, and it's a medallion, like a medallion or a spider's web, and it's all divinely in light. Well, the person's in light, they're not in the emotional, they're not in the physical body any longer,
mm-hmm.
but their spirit is alive and they're traveling through, you know, they travel through. See, I'm getting again the Holy Spirit from me. Chicken skin.
Oof.
So what happens is that I went and I was in the presence with her, letting her know that that's why I'm here, to help her daughter, you know, Esther, with the anatomy of Woodstock. But I'm also here for the healing in the present to help her move through this with her grandson, and that's why I've showed up. Need to continue to carry this on any longer. You know what I mean?
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, and then the thing is that what happened was very interesting. I'm glad you said that, because once I had that conversation, now this was done in the present, and she then realized that now she can leave. Now I can leave and be at peace, because now I know that you've been sent as a messenger to finally orchestrating to help the family. That's why you're there. And I explained to her just telepathically, and looked at her. And she revealed herself. Now, they're very, very shy. Just so you know, don't think they just show up. I mean, you have to really be in a very loving and compassion and inner peace for them to show up. Because they won't reveal themselves, only with love.
Wow. So interesting. Yeah. So that is the, would you say that is the vibration that they are moving at? And maybe that's part of the reason why it's essential to be in that vibration to kind of tune into them?
Yes. Yeah, they won't appear to you like they wouldn't appear to her daughter, Esther, or to the grandson, because they weren't in that vibration where she was at.
Wow.
And I happen to be in the vibration.
Ooh.
Where I could be of service and help through, you know?
So when you said that to her mentally, did you, because you were saying that you could see her, could you see her face? Was it just a form? Was it a light? Could you make out features?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, like a flower. Just think of a diva and a face in it. So a flower with a face in it, like a web of light.
Ooh.
Like a spider web or a medallion,
wow.
You know, mm-hmm. A medallion or a sun, you know, and inside, it's like a real soft, and you can see the face outlined in light that they're looking at you. That the spirit of it is like, okay. And I was taken back myself, and I've been doing this a long time, that she was in a very like a real sensitive, quiet diva watching.
Wow. So when you
see, yeah, it was really, really tremendous, because I was wondering, like, oh, okay, you know, and when she did reveal herself to me and knew that things would be taken care of, then she would stop and start to leave to the other dimensions, realizing that, okay, he's going to take, you know, he's been brought in as a messenger to help, you know, to help them, and that's why he's here, and now I realize that I have to leave now.
So once
I had to let her know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to go to a very peaceful, loving state. You don't need to be in this dimension. You're without a body right now. That this will be taken care of, and this is what we went forward to do. And so he was released from the grandson, because I could see it over Esther that there was a whole complete change when she did leave. I could see the difference where she was.
Ooh.
Not
wow.
Down with the mom. Yeah, you could tell. I mean, she was like more her. She's like a diva herself, like a free spirit, that she can now be free to do what she needs to do to bring this book into Woodstock. Her creativity,
wow.
and her joy was returning.
Wow.
She's bogged down. She's bogged down by this spirit, you know?
So when you had that telepathic message to the mother,
yes.
Did you see her when she, for the lack of a better word, when she disappeared or vanished? What did that look like to you?
Well, all light, you know, just complete white light.
Incredible.
Yeah, just complete white light.
Wow.
And the thing is, she would hide down the stairs. I'd have to go down the stairs because they hide in darkness, you know, because they can't be seen. They don't realize that they're in this dimension, and so they're hiding down in the cellar, like, and I'm going, what are you doing down there? So I brought her up to the...
what are you doing down there? Oh, my gosh.
What are you doing down there?
Oh, my God. That's amazing.
I said, don't hide down there.
Oh.
They came up to the room. Moonlit Sun, and then she revealed herself up in the rooms to me. Oh. That's when I was able to get through to her. Her soul, I spoke to her soul, that it's time to go on, and this will be taken care of. This is why I'm here.
This is so amazing to think that you were just, like you're saying, you were called into there. You just suddenly felt, hey, you know what the heck? I'm going to go out to this Woodstock and this 20th anniversary. And little did you realize what kind of an astounding gold mine would be out there, you know? You were just led there. Now, what was the earliest memory that you have of helping out people with that kind of, you know, either grieving process or being able to see their relatives or friends or what have you who have transitioned over? What's the earliest memory you have of seeing that kind of entity?
Well, I get it, believe it or not, when I'm in Hawaii or if I'm in New Jersey or wherever I am at, actually people's ancestries come to me and from L.A., for example. They would be on the beach up in Hana, and they would come to me and reveal the family member I would describe to them, and they almost jump out of their skin. How did you know that? And I said, well, and I described, I said, your mom's come to me, your grandmother's come to me, your father's come to me, you know, the following, and this is what they're showing me from the heart, what you need to know, and now we know why you're ill. Because of the following, the way you were abused or treated, and each thing. So I worked with people with Parkinson's, and I'm telling you, for 3-4 years, you know, that had Parkinson's in the military. He was a sergeant Marines. Personally, I worked with out of South Carolina, flew him into Hawaii. I helped the woman that was in my life, wanted me to, she was my spiritual partner for 9 years. And her, she said, look, you know, I want you to, I said, you know, you're my partner, you know, she said, like, this is my boyfriend, and it's your obligation to go with me to South Carolina. And the woman that was spiritual said she's asking to help you. Her name's Marcia. And she said, well, she wants you to go. I said, well, you know, this could go on for years, you know. This ain't going to happen just like a few months. And then the doctors called. It was a woman doctor, said, look, you got 2 weeks, that the state will take over your dad's estate and everything. If you don't get here to South Carolina in 2 weeks, he has maybe 2 months to live, then you need to come over here. And that's when I got called in to leave Hawaii. I was in upcountry, you know, we had a beautiful place there. We made sure everybody took care of the home and the retreat center. Went to South Carolina. I went in and they couldn't get his circulation going. His name was Bill. And he was a sergeant Marines, and the doctor looked at me and they couldn't get his circulation going for quite some time, and they said, look, you know, I'm telling you, that's why we're asking you to come. So we made arrangements, and we're over there in South Carolina, and I decided to go because I prayed about it. And we went in, and they kept saying the circulation, that's why we're calling. We're really thinking he's also uptight and everything with the Parkinson's, and we're really concerned that he doesn't have much time. So that's why I want you to come. And before the state takes over. And as I'm in the room, his circulation, this is what they were concerned about, starts coming alive once I walk in the room. Circulation. And the woman, the doctor, she notices it right away, goes, look, we've been trying for weeks here, trying to get the circulation going. His circulation comes alive. I've seen healing before. Now, who are you? Because I said, well, that building was sent to you, bro. I came in to help him. He goes, yeah, but I've never seen anybody's circulation come alive. The reason I called you here is because we can't get a circulation going. Now, what's going on? I said, well, that's what we're here for, to help Bill. that's the type of healing that runs through us as a vessel of light in where the Christ energy, the Christ consciousness, will work through that one of faith to help that soul that's in you know, out of balance, and ready basically to cross over. They said he had 2 weeks to live, the doctor told me. Now, what happens is, I pray about it. Now, his circulation started to come alive, and she had tears in her eyes. She was weeping, going, I've never seen like anything like this. Thank God you're here. I'm glad I called and everything. I'm really concerned, because she's really concerned on him as a human being, that he gets released from this in some way. And once the circulation gets going, then we could do something. So that started the process. Now, just by being in the presence, Kurt, our circulation could come alive. If you have faith and you have the right energies that are aligned in the room with you, anything is possible in prayer, and miracles happen. And it did. And so then I went and I prayed about this, and I was connected to a psychic surgeon. His name was Thomas, and he was in the Philippines, and he's in South Carolina. He lives there. And I got guided to him, and I said, Phil, for Bill, I said, look, Thomas, I need some help regards to, and he goes, you know, Valentine, I'm not supposed to come out in the public eye because they'll think I could be put in jail if I work on him and he comes alive, you know,
whoa,
he comes back to life. And he goes,
he was saying he could get in trouble, you're saying?
Yeah, he could get in trouble as a psychic surgeon, because what happens is, if they're saying the liability of it, let me explain.
Okay.
Life force was it coming alive. So what we did is we had to release that life force into the main form, where it could actually paralyze him, what we were to do. If we didn't do it in harmony with God's blessing around it, it's called a certain name because they have so much information flowing through, where he said, listen, you be at the feet and I'll be at the head. And I'm doing the healing with Thomas, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, he's like, he said, I'm going to pull him. So we brought his life force together, and there's a name for it, and I'll come with it as we're speaking.
Mm-hmm.
When we pull that energy, it's like the Kundalini. He, what he was jammed up about in the physical, emotional, and spiritual, we now brought alive. And then he said, okay, Bill, why don't you take your leg, and I want to see the strength of your leg, and just kick me. And he's like, well, you know, he's against a wall, like, you know, but with on the massage on the table. And he goes, well, come on now, Bill, give me the force of your, give me the strength you have. Now, this guy couldn't even pick his leg up or do anything or do anything at all. And we released this energy in there where he went and kicked, he gave the force of his leg. He was so strong, it's like Godzilla, like gorilla, like Superman came alive now, Captain America. He kicked him, and he threw him against the wall. And I saw Thomas's face, and he was shocked that this,
whoa,
that we actually come back to life. He came back to life. He came back to life, Bill, and I had to take care of him and got a place over there as we're nurturing him back. Now I got him alive, and he lived for 3 or 4 more years when they told me he only had 2 months to live.
Oh my gosh.
There's a certain need for that. We released it, and he said, if you don't do it properly, you could paralyze the person. That's why, I mean, he could have got himself in trouble if anything didn't uncork that area, and it's near the Kundalini. There's a name for it, that it was blocked off in that center of the back area, and his leg, you know, right there in the center of the back. And I can't think of the name right now, but once I do, I'll tell you. But the fact is that this is the type of miraculous healing that I've been around with other healers that have watched it. And like I said, I'm the one with that at feet, and he's at the head.
Incredible.
We switched around. He went to the feet, and I went to the head.
Amazing.
And he got thrown to the wall, Kurt.
It's like a battery. Like, he was like the battery, and you guys were the chargers. You guys are, you know, charging him up. That's incredible.
Yeah, exactly.
So now, and, how long have you, like, oh, I'm sorry, I don't want to cut you off, but my next question will be, you know, how long, you know, you've, you know, maybe when you first realized that you had that Christ consciousness, that ability to be able to plug into that, you know, vibration. So I'd love to hear about that as well.
Yeah, well, it happened on my as I was in the wilderness in Northern California, even more so. I mean, as a child, I came in on my paper route diagnosing people with these prescription drugs. The elderly had poisons in their system, and I knew it. And I said, well, if it's not helping you, why are you taking it? Well, my doctor told me so. I said, well, if it's helping you, I can see. But can you show me these prescriptions at the doctor? No, I'm 10, 11 years old. You know, 8, 9 with my brother.
Oh, man.
People. You know what I mean? And they were like family to me around the neighborhood. And I was like counseling them. And I said, look, would you kindly get them? Would you just get it for me? They're in the cupboard. But they tried to find them while I was in their presence. And they couldn't. They said, you know, they got so frustrated trying, they didn't really want the prescription drugs to show me because they couldn't find them. And they said, you know, forget about that. I'd rather be with you in the presence because I'm happy right now. I couldn't care less about those prescription drugs. That's the kind of effect that it happened as a child that I came in to be in the presence. So it started from there early on my paper route, and it grew and grew, and the healers who come to me, the elders, just keep writing, and I'll be channeling, and that's why I'll be diagnosing people like Edgar Casey. I'm part of that soul group. I brought that up in the conversation with you on last week about, you know, Edgar Casey, the trans channel. People want to look at that.
Right, he would channel while he was sleeping, right? He'd fall asleep, and then people would ask him questions, and he'd give him medical information, and he knew nothing about, right? He'd just go, okay, this is what you need to do.
Right. And so he would get the trans channel and have two people with him. So, and they'd call him the sleeping prophet. Well, they called me the sleeping prophet because I'd be sleeping, and I'd start getting impressions, and then I would start getting the records on the soul, what caused the illness or the blockage, and what time frame, when they were 8, when they were 11. So from the soul that comes in to the grandparent, it doesn't matter what, they'll show me the time frame, what they look like, and I would describe them, and only because it showed to me what they would be, okay, I know God's involved with this. I know that the source of God, because there's no way he would know this. The people would just look at and go, oh my God, this is an anointment from God. I've been asking for an answer, and now you're here as a messenger. You know what I mean?
Incredible.
Yeah. So these are the things that that I would experience. So these are the diagnoses and stuff when I was, the family members come, like I said, and the people ask for a sign. That's what mainly happens when I'm in Hawaii here, in the Hawaiian Islands on Maui, and all the islands I've been on, wherever I am, I would be in the water. I'm not kidding you, and I would be maybe 50 yards or maybe 100 yards in the water, and I'll feel a person, actually the energy, walking on the beach. This woman was distraught, and she asked for a sign that she was walking, because she didn't want to leave the island, and she had something major going on in her life to heal. And I got out of the water and said something was wrong, and I went up to her and then I went and said, let's talk about it. She goes, how did you know about this? I said, I could feel it. She said, I'm leaving the island and we're splitting up, and I really don't want to leave the island to be with my family right now. And this is a mature woman, like in her 60s at the time, and I might have been in my 30s at the time. And she said, I just can't do it here on the island any longer. I got to go back to I believe it was, you know, on the mainland, and could have been Utah or something. I think it was in that area with her family, and she, Montana. It was Montana, and she said, "I really appreciate it because I asked for a message from God to send me somebody that I could. I know that I'm doing the right thing by leaving the island, and my husband." Not working on any longer, and we need to split and everything. And I help people come together. I try to help her. She said, "No, I got the sign now that since you showed up, that I have to leave for now. Now, whoa. If anything changes for me to work out, then I'll listen. But I'm going to be in contact with you." And then she's going to San Clemente, California, with her family. And she sent me pictures for the holidays and with her children and grandchildren. And thanking me for being there for her, that was the message that she needed to go on with. And she, it's very difficult for anybody to leave the Hawaiian Islands. You do not want to leave here unless you're told to go. Because it's like being in heaven, you know?
Wow.
On the earth plane. Yeah, it's like the Garden of Eden. You know, wherever you go, everything's beautiful in Hawaii, you know? And we have 30,000 people, Kurt, a day. 30,000 people a day visiting the Hawaiian Islands. A day.
Wow. So you must have friends from all over the world, knowing all the people that you meet.
Yes. Well, the world comes to us here, and we're very blessed. Now, majority goes over to the city of Honolulu, but then, of course, it spreads out, you know, to all the other islands. But, yeah, I mean, Maui has more rainbows than any other island. Now, every island has its beauty, believe me. And, you know, from Hawaii, I mean, it's the father island, you know, it's the ancient island. Maui is the mother island. It's all, everywhere you go, it's beautiful. You know, the flowers, the mother, you just think of the mother energy or the goddess energy or the feminine energy. That's Maui. And it's the connection. The connections happen here. In Kauai, it's more quiet. It's more, you know, like you want to be meditate, get quiet. It's ancient, you know. And then the Big Island is more, and I talked about that, when the lava and everything, when we had the lavas going off 2 years ago, where it makes new islands. It's the younger island. It's the biggest, like the Wild Wild West. But it takes like an hour just to go anywhere and an hour to get back. I mean, it's so vast and it makes new islands. That's why the lava went off for 88 days that I spoke worldwide on from Hawaii here to help the Big Island to get supplies and stuff in. On my YouTube channel, now you'll see the videos, the 24 videos that I was interviewed globally about helping humanity. And then, as I mentioned to you last week, I was nominated for the Flower of Life Peace Award, along with Ron Van Dyke. He was the one that interviewed me. He had 10 years of broadcast under Paradox Man 316. People can look, and you'll see my 24 videos. But you better off to put my full name in, and Kurt gives it to you. Thomas, Valentine, Mike the Heart, and then Hollick, H is in Happy, O-L-I-C-K. And you'll see those inspirational videos where I get nominated with all the world leaders for 2019 and 2020 recent, because they made the decision in the fall of 2019. Greg Brayton got the award. Everybody knows who Greg Brayton is. You know, and Ron got the award. And then I got nominated with all the presidents from Sun Moon in South Korea. In the United States with Donald Trump. They put me in that category. I go, why'd you do that? He says, well, because they need healing. Little Rocket Man, I call him Little Rocket Man. Some, you know, he's very comical to me. He's a great study for comic relief. Because just the way he is, you know, he's just comical. And the basketball player liked him so much, Dennis Rodman, to fly over there because he wanted to do some type of relation to come into harmony, you know, and as we see that. So he's getting nominated with me. No wonder we're going to need a healing. That's three of them. And so there's 12 that were nominated, and I was nominated along with them. for 2019. Take a look it up. The Flower of Life Peace Award.
Flower of Life Peace Award. Now, something that you had mentioned to me, it was an extraordinary situation where you felt the entire inside of your body being filled with gold.
Yes.
Can you explain that situation? Because I think quite supernatural. Very cool.
Yeah, I was... Say again, Kurt?
It's very cool. Very supernatural.
Yeah, the supernatural. What happened is, again, now when you said that, now my body's getting all the spirit and the chicken skin and the goosebumps with this. Because this is something where you're called to the mountains, like Muhammad. I was called in from San Diego. I lived in La Jolla and Encinitas. And I got called in on it's called the Ascension with Brian Groton from Switzerland. And people can look it up on the Ascension because Gene Dixon predicted things. And I'll share a little bit more about that with the Ascension with Brian. And Brian came into Northern California where I was with an African shaman, a yogi. And her name was Reverend Celeste Starr, with one of my guides and colleagues. Okay. And apparently what happened was is they apparently when I got called in with the promoter Peter Pisecki out of Northern California, he had a construction firm and he worked with the Ashtar Command. And he goes, "Who are you?" And I'm on the phone. And he goes, "Well, I was recommended by this gentleman, this colleague friend of yours said I should actually fly you over here to help me with this work job with the Ascension with Brian Groton." I'm like, you know, lost about 40,000 to promote it to bring people from all around the world into Northern California to near Mount Shasta. And he said, "Well, I'd like to fly you over. They're telling me I'm supposed to fly you over." And I get in there and he makes back his 40,000-50,000, and now he doesn't want to pay me because it happened so quickly and it was easy because I work with promotions and all, and I know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
And the energy was building and you could see the ships there and everything. The ships were definitely in the clouds.
Wow.
Oh yeah, the mother ships and everything. These ships came in and were observing and everything every day I was there. I was in my Bali outfits with all the universal colors like the cosmic universe and Bali clothes that were made specially. They're called Goddess Creation for that wherever I walk, you know, by faith, you know. And so I'm cosmic, right? They call me a cosmic consultant, cosmic son.
It's great. It's great.
The Golden Son. And so he goes to me, "Well, it was so easy for you that I'd rather you just come into the workshop and everything." I said, "Well, that wasn't the agreement." And what transpired there was Brian was resonating. I said, when you would sit next to him, his vibration, you would get a sunburn sensation from the sun and the energy that he was resonating with. Before the workshop, the people were coming in, that he was full with so much light that you would get a sunburn sensation sitting across from him for lunch. And that was happening. But I was already a sun, so I didn't have to worry about getting a sunburn sensation. But the people that were around him would say they would feel this presence they'd never felt before because he would resonate at a certain frequency and divine light that was giving people that feeling of a sunburn sensation, but it wouldn't burn you. It's the difference. You know, the sun will burn you here on this plane, but where we're from, we resonate with divine gold light. And as you spoke of that, what led me to that was now, from the workshop, I meet this African shaman, Reverend Celeste Starr. She works with the divine light. I come onto the property with her partner, Alan, and I'm now brought into the wilderness, and I'm in the waterfalls. They tell me I have 80 acres there in preparing to, so I'm out of the workshop already, did that, did with us complete. But what happened was, instead of people with the money, my gift was to go and be there in Middleton and Harpin Hot Springs. So I was right there in Harpin Hot Springs and Middleton. And now I'm being called into the mountain with, they're reading the scrolls on my life, what I'm here to do. When I say the scrolls, they're reading the records on me about what I was sent here to do in this lifetime. And they started reading it off, the records. And while they were doing that in the waterfalls, the water's gushing and all, I saw all these monarch butterflies on a rock just observing. And above, I could feel this presence above, of watching, like angelic angels. I could feel these presence of purity around me. And these monarchs just kept like flapping their wings and just waiting. They were huge. And they said that these are messengers or guardians that were listening, believe it or not, with the vibration and observing. They're like space beings. You know, they're messengers, these monarchs.
Wow.
And they embody, you know, when people cross over, they say, a butterfly came to me. They transition. So there was definitely a council there of light observing what I was there brought into the mountain, like Muhammad on the mountain, mm-hmm. and Moses in the mountain, like the tablets. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So once they did that, I went into the mountains. Now, I was brought in, and you have to do a cleansing, whatever, to be in your purity. So you want anything in your system. And so I went higher and higher into the elevation of the mountain. And I only had a blue-green algae, water, and just fasting. And oh my God. And then they started opening up to me about, we're going to leave you alone now. And this was like 12, 1 o'clock at night in Harbin Hot Springs in Middleton. I'm in the wilderness. And I'm looking up in the sky. Now, they just leave. Celeste and Alan just leave now at this point. And when you mentioned about the golden light, a ray gun, a golden sun, shot at me to my throat. And now all the divine light, white light and everything around, and I was just in the presence. And what happened was, it's like a ray gun. It was like you can't even believe this is coming at you, but this golden light shot right to my throat chakra and lined me down like a flame of golden light, like right down my chest, all the way down to my root chakra. I was lined in gold. And then when I was lined in gold, I hit the ground. It's like being your body being like in so much joy. When I got hit with the golden light, I was in the presence of this golden angels. I could feel the presence all around me, but I was laughing with ecstasy and like bliss. But I wasn't on ecstasy or anything like that. You know, I'm in my natural state. If people say ecstasy, you're beyond bliss. You can't even put it into words. But in our time, I would say 15 to 20 minutes. But in our time, which is out of time, in the heaven, it was endless. I didn't want to come out of it. I just was over-stimulated and ignited with so much joy. And I was being recharged because I was really exhausted helping in the world. And I just got so filled with this golden light, what we call the golden sun. The three rings into the core of the true sun. I saw it, actually, where the moon covered over the sun. And that's when that... It's like a ray gun, but it just shot out of nowhere. I wouldn't expect that. I thought maybe shooting stars and galaxy of light. I was watching, and out of nowhere, because I was left alone, is when this energy just shot. Now, it's seen and not seen, but my eyes are open spiritually. Now, not only did it shoot into the throat, into the root chakra, The first thing that happened before that is that this light hit me in my third eye into the, and I didn't talk about that last week, it's coming now, the channel. And it hit me in the third eye, and it went, and like electric bolts of white light and golden light just ignited me, like if lightning struck and hit you in the third eye, and it was divine light hitting me, and went, and kept going with the vibration, and that's when I was in so much bliss and joy that I didn't want to come back into that, you know, I didn't want to come out of that energy because I was so divinely stimulated and joy just kept filling every cell of my body. And that's what my true nature is, to be in our happiness, you know, but you have to earn to get there. You just, that's our true nature, is to be in our happiness, you know. Women laugh, if you notice, women laugh and giggle and stuff, and then, you know, because it's their natural thing as a bearing children. They have to laugh like children, you know, they do that. And then the men will come along and want to get, you know, their sense of humor, because they have so much responsibility taking care of the feminine energy, the mother, the children. So they're the hunter, you know, the male energy. So anyway, so I'm in this experience, and I go, oh my God. And then I see golden angels appear to me while I'm in the wilderness, and they're laughing like little Pillsbury boys, or little Pillsbury girls, and they're like cherubs.
Wow.
And I've been in the vibration now of that heavenly existence on the earth plane, experiencing these heavenly golden angels. That's what I was lying to who we really are, the golden angel, before we arrive here. And then we start unlearning that out of our purity. Each soul that comes in is a golden angel. Well, I'm experiencing as an adult, but being very childlike, I'm able to come into through sense of humor, and I'm being ignited and seeing these golden angels. And smiling and laughing and like trying to, like, I hear him in the inner world, in my ears, I'm like, and I see him, actually see him. And that was really quite a presence to be around.
Wow.
Yeah.
So do you feel that your powers had enhanced, and your sensibilities had maybe become more, even more sharpened after that experience?
Oh yeah, because Louise Hay saw Deepak Chopra when I went to Southern California out of the wilderness. Louise Hay almost jumped out of her, and everybody knows, getting chicken skin with Louise Hay. Louise Hay almost jumped out of her skin. She'd never seen nothing like it before. And you know, Louise Hay's been in healing, you know, as you know, for. You know, you could heal your life. Sold like 50 million copies. And she was blown away with her staff trying to figure out who, when I came out, was so pure that she sold the golden angels. And then she went to me when she took a break and I went to take a break while Deepak speaking, Deepak Chopra, with the quantum field and what he was talking about. And she apparently is coming down the stairs, and I was walking up the stairs, and as she was coming down and I'm walking towards her, we embraced one another, and we instantly became oneness. And she leans over to my left shoulder, and she whispers to me and says, I know who you are. I go, Louise, it's nice to see you.
It's incredible.
Yeah, yeah. So
wow.
It was like that, Kirk. I mean, and then I would be invited. I was invited with the lecturers and speakers at her home, and she would always just be in the presence and watch me. and I would be on the phone. She would come upstairs. She looked downstairs. So I was upstairs. She took it from downstairs. She just wanted to be in the present, and was in awe of this energy that I was ignited with. And most people, now, as an example with Louise Hay, this is called a matrix. And this I was with the yogi in Southern California, in Encinitas, with Yogananda's people and everything. That's with Yogananda, with Jesus, and all the meditators that come from all over into Yogananda's. And apparently, what happened was this my friend says, oh, you got to meet this yogi, my teacher. I want him to meet you. I want him to experience this energy that you're with the golden light, you know, this golden sun, because I've experienced it with you. I want to see if he can pick up on it. So let's go visit him. So he says, he didn't tell him. He just said, I want to introduce you to Valentine. And my spiritual name is Amar. Amar from the Heavenly Stars, A-H-M-A-R. And it's Sanskrit from India. Amar Atman Ran. And what that means is, it means the central disk of the central sun. See? Back to the golden sun. See?
Wow.
And that's what it means. Amar from the Heavenly Stars. So, the people on this plane, Amar in India, if you use the Sanskrit, it means the eternal one. But when people are, while I'm walking on this plane, I say it means to unite love. It means for us to unite. My name, Valentine's my family name. 9 generations in my family is my first name. I'm the last generation in the middle. So it's not a Maui made-up name or a made-up name. Thomas Valentine Holland, with H's and happens, right? And apparently, they said to me, he didn't have time to meet with me. And he was blown away. He goes, we need our time to meet with him. He goes, yeah, I'm in a rush right now, and I don't have time to meet with him. Well, he brushed by me, and I didn't know this. And when he brushed by me, apparently, he went back to where he was after his meeting. He went back to his matrix place, which is a healing center, and he had this presence went all over him when he went by me, and he felt this golden light go through him, and he goes, oh my God, where is he? I want to meet with him. He goes, well, he's gone. We can't, what do you mean you can't find him? He said, a golden light going through me.
Wow. Said,
my whole body, just my pinky brushed by you, and I was lit up in gold. My whole body went in the presence of gold. I've never experienced anything like it. He said, the only thing I can remind, that he gets a whole, his staff, they're all looking for me all day long. They couldn't find me. And then finally, I get to his center. I'm being brought over, and he said, well, I want to meet you because I experienced this. My pinky brushed against you, and I became all gold. He said, brother, the only thing I can reminds me of this, that I know of, is Muhammad on the mountain. Muhammad was on the mountain praying, and this white divine light went inside him and ignited him.
Wow, and little did he realize your experience up on your own mountain. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
And the Holy Spirit, the chicken skin's happening.
Oh,
now.
Boy.
Yeah, oh, girl.
Oh, man, you know, this is great. This is great.
In the world, they oh, boy. And I got to give credit to the women in the planet because I work with the feminine energy, with the male energy, you know, the balance of the male. And I go, well, we say oh, boy, around the world. They say, oh, girl. We got to include the feminine energy.
Yeah. It's great. It's funny because you're talking about, you know, uniting the love, and you know that's a little cherub, the little Valentine cherub does. It shoots a little arrow and bloop, you know, and then they're in love. So it's really quite, it's incredible that you've become the embodiment of these things. Now we've got about 3 minutes left here. What would you like to? I know you've got people can I say in here how people can reach you?
Sure.
Can I put your so Valentine Maui. ValentineMaui, like Maui, @icloud.com. That's the best email for them to reach you, right, Valentine?
Yes, that's my direct email, because if you used it, yes, best to direct to me is best. I have a Gmail. If people don't have iCloud, it's the same thing, valentinemaui@gmail.com. But I have, like you know, 100,000 Gmails, you know what I mean? Like, a lot of emails come in.
And then,
around the world. And then
also they can find you on Facebook. And you've got a lot of Facebooks up there, so the one that they need to find is the profile photo of you wearing your rainbow shirt with all the McCalls on you.
That's correct.
So you look like the McCall.
It'll say a rainbow shirt with Hawaii on it. That's the account to put it in, because the other accounts were because they were developing a major movie on my life. I was contacted by Hollywood with William Osco. He did Alice in Wonderland, the musical, and he said, look, you have a very important message for the world, and I have to watch over you. He's Marlon Brando's cousin.
Wow.
And he said, look, I want to do this story because I need to help humanity. I got too involved with Hollywood, and I wanted to be a ball player like you. I was a baseball pitcher in New York, and people will see my life story. If you look on the YouTube channel, you'll see under the Hall of Fame nomination also, and Diamonds of Love is my life story, where I talk about where each Diamonds of Love is what the movie is about. It's our divine spark of light that we need to share with every soul wherever you go. They developed this with me in Woodstock. Believe it or not, there's a channel.
Wow.
They sold on me in the 25th anniversary and said, Valen, a bar from the heavenly stars.
Oh boy, we got like 20 seconds left here.
Okay.
So thank
anyway,
you.
That's the best for now. We will continue on another
yes.
conversation.
Oh my gosh.
Go ahead, Kurt.
This is great. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Yeah, wonderful. And we just sent our golden roses to the hearts of mankind, and rainbows ahead.
I love it. Rainbows ahead.
Beautiful, Kurt.
This is Blythe Baines, and you're listening to Inspirado Projecto.